Friends, it's an honor to have you worship with us today here at Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Gaithersburg, Maryland. Today is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. If you would just at this moment, just take a moment to let us know you're worshiping with us by checking in. You can use, if you're watching on a computer, fill up as the instructions on the screen. But if you've downloaded our church app, just go to the worship tab and you'll see the check-in form right there. And let us know you're here. Let's prepare for worship.
Christ, would you please stand with me for worship? We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We gather as the people of God to offer our repentance and praise, to pray for the unity of the church and the renewal of our common life. Trusting in God's mercy and compassion, let us ask for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another and to the Father. Lord, have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy on us.
Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of pride and intolerance. Christ, have mercy on us.
Christ, have mercy on us.
Lord Jesus, you pardon the sinner and welcome the repentant. Lord, have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy on us.
May Almighty God grant us pardon and peace, strengthen us in faith, and make us witnesses to Christ's love.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace grace to God's people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy Son, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory
Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We know what a blessing it is when people who are unexpected reach out to us with words of encouragement. So let's be those people who do that for others today. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of peace.
Friends, again, I want to welcome all of you to Good Shepherd. Just a few quick announcements for you. Today is Super Bowl Sunday, and one of the things we've been asked to collect this year for Gaithersburg Help is size 4 and 5 diapers. I just want to put it on your radar that that collection will continue into this week as well. So there's still opportunity to come and support that project. So just take note of that and the link there. Pastor Ted's class, I'll just spotlight this one more time. His class will be continue to be available the normal ways on our website and Facebook. But if you'd like to engage him via Zoom, he'll be leading that class live. If you join via Zoom, you'll have the opportunity to ask him questions. So go to communications@goserve.net and send us an email if you need that Zoom link, and we'll get it to you quickly. 10:15 every Sunday morning, we have opportunities for people of all ages to engage in Christian education. I just want to keep spotlighting that, and we've been very, very pleased throughout the many months that you've continued to be involved in that. Wednesday night, this week, we'll conclude our series on Hope for Hard Times, Lessons from Elijah. So join us for that half-hour worship service. Then the following week is Ash Wednesday, so you'll see a lot in the coming week about Ash Wednesday and the season of Lent. Just know there will be multiple services, opportunities for people of all ages, and we will be sending out ashes in the mail, so keep an eye out for that. I would also just take note, if you don't have ashes, we'll simply also recommend that you just use some oil, and we'll bless the oil as part of that service as well. And two more, out the front door of the church in a cooler, we have Lenten devotional booklets that you can pick up at your convenience. They'll be made available beginning today. We'll just keep monitoring that and keep replenishing that, but we ask that you just take one for your household. And lastly, 3 weeks from today is our next New Connection event. If you're interested in joining the church or interested simply in learning more about the church, send Mary Jo an email and we'll get you connected to that. But it's from 1 to 2:15 on Sunday, February 28th. We'll continue with our reading, and Margo is going to read for us this morning.
The reading is from 1 Corinthians, chapter 9. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no grounds for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I might share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Good morning. It's so great to be here to share this lesson with you today. Adults are trying to sign up to get a shot that keeps you from getting a bad case of COVID-19 sickness. But it's really hard to sign up for that shot. My parents were able to get their shot about a week ago, but their appointment, the place they signed up, was quite a distance from their house. And wouldn't you know it, the day that they were able to go get the shot, it snowed. So my brother-in-law, Michael, he drove over an hour from his house to their house to pick them up and then to drive them to their appointment another hour away. I thanked him. It was a big deal. But it wasn't surprising at all, because all of us we'll do whatever we can to help our family and friends be well, because we love them. Many very special people are healers, dedicating their lives to helping people be well. As we will soon hear in the gospel lesson, our Jesus story for the day, Jesus himself was a healer. But before we talk about the gospel, I would like to talk to you a little bit about a great Christian lady who was one of the most famous healers in all of history. Her name is Florence Nightingale. Florence was born in the city of Florence, Italy, in 1820. That's 200 years ago. She was super smart and loved to learn. She studied everything: Italian, Latin, Greek, philosophy, history, math, that was her favorite, writing, and eventually nursing. At the age of 17, she wrote these words in her diary: "God called me in the morning and asked me, would I do good for him?" Because of this message from God, Florence decided to go to a Lutheran school of nursing in Germany. Florence began nursing in London and quickly became a leader in the hospital care. In 1843, she became the first woman ever to run a field hospital. She read so much and loved to learn so much that she learned this great new idea that there were these things called germs that made people sick, and that these germs could be washed away. So she organized her hospital to be much cleaner, and she started this crazy new idea of washing her hands all the time, something we still do 200 years later. As you can see in this slide, she had the nickname, the Lady with the Lamp. And she got that nickname because she would go check up on people all the time and to make sure they were okay well into the night. Before Florence took over the hospital, only a bit more than half the people were getting well enough to go home. After Florence took over, almost all the patients, 98% of them, got better. So everyone, doctors, presidents, even kings and queens, wanted Florence to teach them how to run hospitals. And Florence's detailed reports and rules created what are known as the modern nursing practices, many of which we still use. Nursing meaning taking care of the sick. Florence believed her nursing honored a loving and generous God. And this is what she said. She said that her life, her words, showed how a woman of very ordinary ability has been led by God in strange and unaccustomed paths to do his service. God has done all, and I nothing. I've worked hard, very hard, that is all, and I have never refused God anything. In today's gospel story, Jesus goes to his friend's house, Peter's house, where Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law, who was sick with fever. That evening, everyone in the area brought their sick family and friends to Jesus to be healed. Because as you remember, all of us will do whatever we can to keep our family and friends well, because we love them. And Jesus healed all of them because God loves them too. So it shouldn't surprise you that, like Florence, you can honor God by doing whatever you can to take care of your own health and other people's health too. That includes washing your hands, eating well, sleeping well, wearing those masks, and praying for God to use his healing power for everyone who is sick. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for all the healers. including Jesus and Florence Nightingale. Help us be healers too, with the clean and healthy things we do. And please help all the sick people in this world. Amen.
Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace be unto you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd say somewhere between 25 and 28 years ago, when my wife was practicing law, her father called her one day and asked her to represent a family in the church. And thanks be to God, her firm said, "Do it," and they said, "You can do it pro bono." So Peggy was a faithful member of the church all her life, and she had taught the three-year-old Sunday school class for years and years and years. But what had happened was her husband Frank had a massive stroke, and he couldn't speak, couldn't communicate, could no longer do anything on his own. He was very much, all of a sudden, in a vegetative state. And so Peggy desperately needed someone who could help walk her through the incapacitation proceedings in the court system. She needed to get power of attorney so she could just take control of all of his affairs. And all the while, it was just gut-wrenching for her, saying, she was basically saying, "I don't want to do this, but I know I need to do this for insurance reasons and also so she could get the help she needed." But she kept saying to everyone, I know I can still take care of him. I can communicate with him. It seems like when I talk to him, I know what he needs. I know what he needs just by the blink of his eye, what he needs." People thought she was just going to be in way over her head. They really kept encouraging her to put him in a nursing home where he could have full-time care, but Peggy said, no way, I am going to take care of him myself. And in a nutshell, because of Pennsylvania law at that point, Frank had to be in the courtroom to prove he was no longer able to communicate his wishes. So Francis had to question the doctor on the stand. And the doctor said, without a doubt, this man will never be able to speak or communicate again. And Francis said it was kind of gut-wrenching to look at Frank and see the tears in his eyes. But the court system declared him incapacitated. And with that, Peggy took Frank home and began this valiant effort to care for him full time. And it's interesting to note that Peggy asked for a Stephen minister from her church to accompany her and talk to her and offer her support. And we know that here at Good Shepherd, the power of Stephen ministry to have a team of trained Christian caregivers to come alongside people in need. We've had that for 20 years. It's just been an incredible blessing that is so underestimated how important that is. The situation that I've been telling you about seems so tragic, but you really need to learn a little bit more about that couple. Frank, prior to his stroke, would hang out in the same bar with the same group of friends, and Peggy reached out to them and said, I really need your help. I need your help now. Frank needs your help. So with that, they built a ramp into that bar so Frank could come and spend quite a few hours sitting with them and still connecting to them, being a part of the same group. Peggy was a bookkeeper, and her company said, you can telecommute, you can do it in your own time. So whenever Frank was asleep, she would get her work done. She would bring the grandchildren and put the grandkids in his arms so he would have that feeling of touch and remembering how much he was loved. But Peggy made one request of Frank. She said, you're going to church with me every week. So for the first time in his life, Frank became a churchgoer. He'd be wheeled into the corner of the sanctuary, and he would receive communion every single week and participate in worship. Yeah, and then Francis and I moved away. I took a new call, but we still got the church's newsletter. And this is many, many, many years ago now, but I remember Francis opening it up one time and reading the list of Sunday school teachers for the new year. And she's reading through this list. She got to the 3- and 4-year-old class. There's Peggy, there's someone else, and there's Frank. And Francis called her father and said, for real, Frank's teaching? How in the world is that possible? And his response was very enthusiastic, but talked about how some things have changed. He said he's still in a wheelchair, but amazingly he can communicate now. He said he has some limited use of his hands. He has this machine that enables him to communicate, and he loves teaching these kids. And the kids just adore him. They'll talk to him. They'll climb on his lap. They'll hug him. They'll talk to him the best they can, and he'll communicate back to them the best he can. But he described was a powerful connection, a powerful connection. And I remember that story, and I think to myself, it's a story about the power of healing. Some would look at Frank and say, yeah, he improved, but he really was never fully healed. He was never the same person he was before the stroke. But, you know, ultimately, the healing of God, healing is about becoming more and more whole, becoming more and more the person God is calling us to be, and realizing that part of this life is about learning to become a servant and a faithful witness to God. You know, in the text today, Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever. You can play around with that image a little bit. But one of the things you could say is all of a sudden she's sidelined. She's by herself and not able to really engage the world around her. But other people recognized her sidelined state. Peter, Andrew, James, and John, they let Jesus know, hey, here is this woman we love who's sidelined because of her health. And Jesus quickly goes to her, engages her, holds her hand, lifts her up, and then it says the fever left her. And immediately, what did she do? It says she got up and she began to serve. And I think many people will read that story and view her response as this, you know, an incident that happened on this particular Sabbath day. And indeed, it's a wonderful response. She bounces back, she rises up, she cooks a meal, she serves others some drink, possibly. But the text says far more than that. The original translation says the fever left her, and as a result, from that point on, she was continually serving. Continually serving. She became a servant. In a sense, it was her daily existence. It's interesting to note that James and John were two of the people who witnessed this whole event. And it's not too far from this point that the two of them get in an argument about who's the greatest in the kingdom of God. They ask Jesus that question, and remember what Jesus says, whoever wants to be first of all must be servant of all. You know, Jesus never talked about volunteering. Nowhere does it say, well, just give 1 hour a week to me on behalf of this Jesus movement. Jesus continually was talking about being a servant every day, every week of your life. And you know what servanthood is. You give away yourself daily to bless the community, bless your family, bless the people around you. And when we embrace that call to be a servant, we're constantly on the lookout for ways in which God is calling us into action at the church and outside the church. We're looking for ways to serve coworkers and friends and neighbors and strangers. Servants are always looking to reaffirm commitments. They're always looking for new challenges. They're looking for new ways to interact and connect and speak to the world. A servant is someone who wakes up and realizes, hey, my job today is to make someone else's life better today and bless them. Volunteers are important in the world. Volunteers do nice things. They help out in spurts, but then they walk away. People who understand their life is a servant, they recognize they are always, always on call and always ready to respond. We sometimes ask the confirmation students, what do you want on your tombstone? And they aren't always thrilled to play that game, but you get some interesting responses to that. But my friends, what do you want written on your tombstone at the end of your life? Do you want it said, I was a volunteer for Jesus? Or would you rather it be said, I was a servant of Jesus my whole life? You know, we can't help but we have to remember the final night of Jesus' life. He got up from the dinner table and washed the feet of his followers. And we remember that was a humble act, a profound act, but it was an act of servanthood to set the example for us. Jesus said, do as I do. That's how you show love. Our call is always to follow Christ 24/7. The motto of our church is go serve. And so what I would say, friends, people of Good Shepherd, all who are worshiping with us, all who will find this someday, the call for us always is to give of ourselves daily, serving the Lord, serving whoever we come across, and serving this world that has so much need, but we serve for a world that needs a lot of love. Amen.
Thank you. eagle's wings. There you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to the angels God's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun.
Let us pray together the prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy.
Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console,
to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. We are called to share our gifts together. There will be a slide on your screen about how to share your offerings here at Good Shepherd, and we give such thanks for those who partner together with us in this ministry. Let us pray for the gifts that are received. Great saving God, you have gathered us into one baptism, regardless of our backgrounds and conditions. Therefore, we praise you with our tithes and our offerings. May they join with others to become a mighty river, bringing your peace and healing to the world. Amen.
Clap your hands, all ye people, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all ye people, lift up your voice and clap your hands.
Clap your hands, all ye people, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all ye people, lift up your voice and clap your hands. God has gone up with a shout, for the Lord is the sound of the trumpet. Shout joyfully unto the Lord, all the earth bring forth into song. Rejoice and sing praise. Clap your hands, all ye people, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all ye people, lift up your voice and clap your hands. Clap your hands.
Sing to the
shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, O ye people, lift up your voice and clap your hands. Clap your hands, clap your hands.
Amen. Trusting in God's power to heal, let us offer our prayers for all who are in need. We thank you, O God, for you are a God of healing. We pray for the church's many ministries of healing, for faith-based hospitals, hospice care programs, and military chaplains, for those serving in prisons, camps, and care facilities. We pray for Tom Turner and Stephen ministers and leaders of every time and place. Bring your healing presence to all programs who seek to heal. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the health of the earth, for its many animals and their habitats, for all created life, that we may continue to strive to protect fragile and precious areas. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the health of people around the globe, for international health organizations and Lutheran World Relief, for the Red Cross and all others who seek to bring aid and relief for those affected worldwide by this pandemic. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for wholeness and healing in our nation. We pray for FEMA, for the National Health Service and the National Guard in their needed work, for the safety of our nation's elected leaders. Bring an end to domestic violence, prejudice, and civic terrorism of any kind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for a halt to this pandemic, for all who have contracted COVID-19 and still feel its effects, for healthcare workers, for the prompt distribution of vaccines, for all who have had loved ones to die of this virus. Be with those who are seeking to help. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are sick or suffering, for those with chronic pain, for those experiencing despair, for all who we name here, Joel and Doris Berg, June Bingaman, Bruce Brown, Mike Camarado, Butch Cotter, Elsie DeWall, Franz Foltz, Walter and Russell Kleiman and their parents, Polly Matkovich, Margaret Miller, Ann Pratt Proctor, Tamara Price, Brian Troutman, Mort, and all those who we lift up now. Stand by them and give them a friend in every need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
On this Super Bowl Sunday, we pray for those who are hungry, who on this day don't even have a bowl of soup to eat. Bless Gaithersburg Help and all families who will receive the diapers that are collected this week. Like loaves and fishes, multiply our efforts and provide for their every need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for ourselves and for this congregation. Give us steady trust in your power and health in our weakness. Bless the partners of Good Shepherd, especially Michael and Debbie Hirschberger, Brandon and Jamie and Tenley Higgs, Artis Hill, Mike and Ruth Hill, and Alex Hodak. We give you thanks for all who support this ministry. Bless our partnership together and make us effective witnesses in your world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise you for the faithful departed and for their lives of service to others, for Florence Nightingale and her witness to your call, for Mary Nuss and her praise through her music, for Pastor Dave Brighton and all who have died this week. We pray that despite sickness and death, at our end we will join with them to find our wholeness in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Go into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen.
Peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.